A lot of the time, we will be given forces in the x and y plane, and we will need to know how to break those forces into x and y components. When we break them into such components, they are called rectangular components. So let's draw a coordinate system like this and draw a force applied 30 degrees away from the positive x-axis. We can draw the x and y components of this force like this. Now if we want to calculate what these values are, we can move one of the components like this to form a right angle triangle. After that, you just need to keep in mind trigonometric ratios. So sine is opposite over hypotenuse, and cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse. The hypotenuse becomes the magnitude of the force, while the sides become the components of the force. When we have multiple forces, we can break all of them into x and y components. Then if we add up each individual x components and y components, we can figure out the x and y component of our resultant force. In simple terms, let's say we have an object like this and many different forces are applied to it. We can take all of those forces, break it into components, and then we can represent all of these forces with two component forces. These two components will have the same exact effect as did all of the other forces. We can go even further by finding the magnitude of the resultant force. That way, we can show one single force which accounts for all the other forces that affected the object. To do that, notice how our x and y components create a right-angled triangle. The magnitude is simply the hypotenuse of this triangle, so we can use the Pythagorean theorem to figure it out. All of this will make more sense when we do examples, so let's get started. Let's take a look at this problem where we have two forces applied to an object. We need to find the resultant force and its direction measured from the positive x-axis. The first step is to break down all the forces into x and y components. Let's focus on the 400 Newton force. Let's draw the x and y components of this force. Now we can move one of these components to create a right angle triangle like this. You can see that the x component is the adjacent length and the y component is the opposite length with respect to the angle that's given. So remember, the 400 Newton force is the hypotenuse of this triangle. Since we want to figure out the adjacent length, we need to use cosine because that's adjacent over hypotenuse. Let's write it down. Next, the y component. For that, we will use sine since that's opposite over hypotenuse. So again, what we are looking for is with respect to the angle. Since we're trying to find the y component, we see that it's opposite to our angle. That's why we used sine. This is not always the case. Do not think that y components are always sine and x components are always cosine. This is a pitfall many students fall into. Now let's focus on the 800 Newton force. Let's draw the components. First, the x component of the force. Notice how with the 45 degree angle that's given, the x component is actually opposite to the angle, which means we need to use sine. So let's write it down. Next, the y component. This time, it's the adjacent length, so we need to use cosine. The next step is to sum all of the x-axis components and the y-axis components. We will start with the x-axis components, and we will pick up and to the right to be positive. So we have both x components of our two forces. Since both of the components are pointing to the right, they are both positive. Let's simplify. Next, the y-axis components. Notice how one of our y components is facing up while the other one is facing down. So our 800 Newton force has a negative y component. Let's simplify. You can see that we got a negative value. All it means is that this vector is pointing down instead of up since we picked up to be positive. Now the two values we found are the x and y components of the resultant force. To clarify this, let's draw these vectors. So for the x component, we have a vector that's pointing to the right, and for the y component, we have a force pointing straight down. Now if we draw our parallel lines, you can see that the diagonal is indeed our resultant force. To find it, all we need to do is use this equation. It's just the Pythagorean theorem. Let's plug in our values. Solving gives us the magnitude of our resultant force. Now we need the angle from the positive x-axis. That's easy to figure out using tan. Tan is opposite over adjacent. So let's write it down. Opposite is the y component, and the adjacent is the x component. Let's solve. And those are answers. Let's take a look at this problem where we have to find the resultant force and the angle. So as before, we can draw the components. Now let's move them so that each forms a triangle. We will first focus just on force F1. This is exactly like before. So the x component is opposite to the angle, so that will be sine. Let's write it down. Next, the y component, which is adjacent, so we use cosine. Now let's look at force F2. So we aren't given an angle, instead, we're given this little slope triangle to figure out the components. The key here is to realize that this slope triangle is a similar triangle to the right angle triangle we drew. So we can use the ratios given to figure out the components. For the x component, we use 5 over 13. Easiest way to see this is to look for corresponding sides. So notice how on the mini triangle, the side length of 5 corresponds to the same side as our big triangle. Now for the y component, we use 12 over 13. Again, notice how the 12 length side corresponds to the y component side of our big triangle. If you keep that in mind, using the slope triangles becomes second nature. Now that we have all the components, let's find the resultant force by adding up the x and y components. We will pick up and to the right to be positive. Both x components point to the left, so they're both negative since we picked right to be positive. Next, the y components. Notice how for force F1, we have the y component facing down, while the y component of force F2 faces up. So remember to use proper positive and negative signs based on which sides you pick to be positive. Now that we have the components of our resultant force, we can figure out the magnitude. To find the angle, let's draw the vector components. Since both components we found were negative, they face opposite to the way we picked to be positive. In other words, the x component faces left and the y component faces down. Now let's calculate the angle using tan. This angle we found is measured from the negative x-axis, and the question wants it to be measured counterclockwise from the positive x-axis. To do that, all we need to do is add 180 degrees, which gives us our answers. Let's take a look at this problem where we need to figure out force F and its angle so that the resultant force would have a magnitude of 8 kilonewtons and be directed along the x prime axis. The first step is to break down the forces given to us into x and y components. Let's focus on the 4 kilonewton force first. So the x component is opposite to the angle, so it'll be sine. The y component is adjacent to the angle, so it'll be cosine. Now for force F. We don't have a magnitude or an angle, but that's all right. We can still break it into components. The x component is opposite to the angle, so it'll be sine, and the y component is adjacent to the angle, so it'll be cosine. We have one more force, which is the 6 kilonewton force, but that only has an x component since it's directed along the x-axis. So in the question, we're told that the magnitude of our resultant force is 8 kilonewtons, and it's 30 degrees above the positive x-axis. If we draw it separately like this, we can figure out its x and y components. The x component is adjacent to the length, so it'll be cosine, and the y component is opposite to the angle, so it'll be sine. Now we can write the sum of our components. Let's start with the x components. We will pick up and to the right to be positive. You'll notice that unlike the other questions we covered before, we're working backwards. We have the x and y components of our resultant force, so that's what's on the left side. On the right side, we have the x components of the other forces. Let's simplify. Now for the summation of the y components. Let's simplify this as well. We now have two equations with two unknowns. You can solve them any way you like. That gives us our answer. So remember, we didn't find the resultant in this problem. What we found was force F so that our resultant force would have a magnitude of 8 kilonewtons and be directed along the x prime axis. That should cover the types of problems you will face in this chapter. In the next video, we will cover how to break forces in three dimensions. Thanks for watching and best of luck with your studies.